Well, hello. Well, this morning we are going to be doing a map on Africa and East Asia in the post-classical period, which means we're going to be talking a lot about Japan. We're going to talk about Japanese feudalism. We are going to talk about Silk Road and how it's booming in trade and how Asia is going to be the wealthiest part of the world. Muslims are second and Europe is the poorest. So those are the topics we'll be covering this week on top of Africa. This week is actually one of my favorites, so I think it's a ton of interesting content. I think it's just really good. And by the way, it's a two-chapter week! Yes! You know how we haven't had one of those for a while? Aren't you glad they're back?
Yes.
Yes. Huh?
I thought there was no test on Wednesday.
There's always a test on Wednesday, Kane. Always and forever. Friendly reminder, tomorrow you do have a vocab quiz 1 through 10. Monday you have 11 through 20. Tuesday 21 through 30. You have a test on Wednesday, even though some of us were hoping it wasn't there. And yeah, questions, concerns, comments. It's a normal week. Just a two-chapter week. How much fun? Ugh, you people. All right. Here we go. Why do I have cords everywhere? All right, here we go. All right, these are your Canary Islands. Your Canary Islands have a crop that is only found here for right now. Does anyone know what the Canary Islands have? No. They don't have bananas. Bananas are from Malay. They have sugar. They're the only place in Afro-Eurasia that has sugar. Now, eventually, they're going to take that sugar and bring it to the Americas, and then obviously we're going to have major sugar production. So if it's only found really in one place, do you think a lot of people have access to sugar? No. Who do you think gets access to sugar? Well, no, the Africans, sure, some people do, but it's only the wealthy, the incredibly wealthy have access to sugar. And it's so rare at this point that people have sugar that people, even royalty around the world, have never seen it before. Now keep in mind, chocolate is an American thing. So no one in the world in Eurasia is eating chocolate. Can you imagine a life without chocolate? I can't. I would not want to live in this world. So Timbuktu, we have, which is a major trading city. And then we have Gao, another major trading city. Congo is a kingdom. And of course, we're going to draw in the delta. And then we have, what river is this? The Nile, yes. The longest river in the world. No, it's the second longest river, isn't it? Isn't the Amazon the longest?
Yeah.
Kingdom of Aksum is located right here, which is a big deal, which we're going to talk about here. Ethiopia is over here, which is the foundation of the cradle of life for all human civilization. Then we have Zimbabwe. And then we have the Kalahari Desert. Fun fact, my brother's in South Africa right now, and he went through the Kalahari Desert on Monday. Calamari. I'm a little hungry. Well, Jared ruined my day, so I might as well live my best life. Right, Jared? Oh, I hate you so much. I hate you so... I'm trying to spell right now, but I just want you to know I hate you. That's Madagascar. Of course, you've seen that stupid movie. It's a stupid movie. I've never seen it. I've just seen, like, parts of it. Such a stupid movie. No, we're not watching it in class, Evan. That's ridiculous. All right. There's your Atlantic. Okay, you need 5 boxes, please. What? How old were you? I don't even want to know.
That was for a reason. I was like 10 years old. We went to our friend's house.
I hate you. How many times have I told you I hate you? Racking them up today. What are your parents... I don't want to know. I don't ask, or I don't like asking. Songhai Empire, Trans-Siberian Trade. Trade route. And maritime. Trade route. Alright. So the first thing we're going to do is the Kingdom of Ghana. For me, it's going to be this light green color. Just remember, you don't need to copy my color selection, but you can if you want to. Kingdom of Ghana is located over here. It is going to be the first major regional kingdom in Africa. The Kingdom of Ghana is going to be conquered by the Kingdom of Malai here in just a few moments. But it is the first regional kingdom in North Africa. It is going to be the first trading empire, so it is going to be pretty damn influential. Then it's going to be conquered by the Kingdom of Malai, which will be this pretty blue color. Kingdom of Malai is going to be the wealthiest, have the wealthiest people to ever live, control it. That's Mansa Musa. Mansa Musa is the single wealthiest person to ever live in anywhere on the planet. That includes wealthier than Jeff Bezos, by the way. Mansa Musa is going to go on a Hajj because he's a Muslim, and he's going to go to Hajj to Mecca. And on his way to Mecca, he's going to throw gold coins. He's going to throw so many gold coins, he devalues gold for 400 years. Yeah, that's how much money my man has. Kingdom of Malai is very cool. We're going to talk about a guy, his grandfather's name is Sundita. Sundita is going to start the Kingdom of Malai. Mansa Musa is going to be the ruler during the Golden Age. Then we have the Songhai. For me, it's going to be this ugly red color. Now, Songhai is also going to be a regional trading power as well. They are going to use their influence over the Trans-Saharan trade route. Of course, in this region up here of Africa, what's here? Yeah, it's the desert. It's the Saharan desert. So the Trans-Saharan trade is going to open because of what animal is going to allow trade to occur? Camels. So the invention of camels, and obviously camels aren't invented, but the idea of bringing them from Saudi Arabia to Africa is the invention component. Does that make sense? So the invention of camels in Africa by the Muslim traders is going to open up a whole new world of trade, and that is in Trans-Saharan, and that is going to facilitate worldwide trade. Okay. Then we have the Trans-Saharan trade route. For me, is going to be black. So it's just going to be an arrow. So the Trans-Saharan trade route is going to be coming across. This is not working. Is going to be coming across the continent through around here and go into Timbuktu. You're also going to see that it is going to go north to Spain. Because what is in Spain? Who is in Spain at this point? The Muslims are in Spain. Al-Andalus is in Spain, and they are major traders as well. You're going to see Timbuktu is going to be a major trading city. That's where most trading is going to occur. So it is going to be a worldwide trading spot. Then we're going to have maritime trade. For me, is going to be this pretty blue. Maritime trade is going to be inside the Red Sea. And it is going to go along the coastline of Africa. Now, the coastline of Africa at this point is going to be incredibly active in the Indian Ocean Basin, which is where they're trading to and from. And you're going to see that it's going to create a whole new economy. And this new economy is going to really shift. Okay. It's going to really allow both India and Africa to thrive. So there are two major trading regions in Africa at this time. You have the Trans-Saharan and the Indian Ocean Basin. Those are your two major trading locations in Africa at this time. Now, as you see, I did color in a little bit of the Saudi Arabian Peninsula. You may want to do that as well, just so we have a little familiarity. And then you're just going to color in the rest of your map. in just like normal. That's the end of your coloring. So there are two major trading components in Africa. You have the Trans-Saharan trade, and then you have the Indian Ocean basin. They are completely separate. There's not a ton of connection at this time. Eventually, they will become more connected. In Africa, the most popular religion will be Islam. Okay. However, there is one kingdom that becomes Christian, and it's called the Kingdom of Aksum. They are the only place in Africa that adopts Christianity by choice. You're going to see that in Africa today, Christianity is probably one of the most popular religions in Africa, but that's because it was forced on them during colonization. During colonization, you have a bunch of white people from Europe forcing them to adopt Christianity. The Kingdom of Aksum, which is you're seeing over here on this coast, is the only place in Africa that naturally adopt Christianity because they wanted to, which is pretty cool. And AP loves that crap. So they're the only place in the whole continent that adopted Christianity, which makes them unique. And everywhere else is pretty much going to turn Muslim. Why is Islam going to be so popular? Who's bringing it? The traders, absolutely. Now think about it. If you had all these people who make tons of money and have all these goods and that can bring you a lot of money, are you going to convert to their religion because it's probably better for you financially? Yeah, and that's exactly what's going to happen. Like I've already mentioned, in Malai, we have a guy named Sundita. Sundita literally converts to Islam in order to attract Muslim traders. His grandson, Mansa Musa, happens to be a devout Muslim. So it kind of worked out. But Sundita only converts in order to attract Muslim traders to his empire. And so it's done as a financial decision, not a religious decision. But Islam, pre-European colonization, is going to be the most popular religion in Africa. I'll give you about 30 more seconds, then we're going to flip it over. And during this time, we have a new crop that arrives in Africa from Southeast Asia, and it's bananas. Now you may be thinking, like, who the hell cares about bananas? Well, I care about bananas because I eat a banana every day, even though I really don't like them. I really don't. But they're, like, healthy. Do you love bananas? I don't really like them, but they're, like, super healthy. You know, they've got a lot of potassium and stuff. So, like, as an old person, I need to eat bananas. So I eat a banana every single day, even though hashtag regret. Bananas are going to increase the population of Africa, which is pretty cool. No, we don't care about that? Cool. Whatevs. All right, here we go. Flip it over. This one is a little bit more challenging, but really not that bad either. All right, so let's start way over here. We have the Telkomen Desert. Telemachan Desert. We have Tibet. We have the Bay of Bengal. This is known as Mongolia. Of course, we have the Yellow River, the Yangtze River, we have the Yellow Sea, we have the Sea of Japan, then we have the East China Sea. And then the South China Sea. We also have Manchuria over here. And you need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 boxes. First one is called Nara State. That is the foundation of Japanese society. Then we have the Silla Kingdom. Silla Kingdom is a foundation of your Korean culture. Then we have the Sui Dynasty, which is the continuation of the Chinese dynastic system. Then we have the Tang. Now the Tang Dynasty is going to overthrow the Sui, and they are going to be the cultural heartbeat of China. Then we have the Jin Empire. The Jin Empire is going to be kind of a fluke. It don't last long. Then we have the Southern Song Dynasty, which has its own kind of cultural components. And then we have the Song Dynasty. Then we have the Grand Canal. And the Grand Canal, for its time period, was the largest engineering project in the history of the world. What? All right. So, let's start with the Nara State. For me, it's going to be blue. Nara State is the first empire or major aspect of Japanese culture. It is going to only be in southern Japan, and they are going to unify and create a centralized government down here. It's not going to last. It lasts a pretty good time, I guess. It's not a huge empire. What's up? Grand Canal. Canal. Yeah, that's supposed to be a C. It doesn't really look like a C. Is that better? Grand Canal. All right, then you have the Silla Kingdom. The Silla Kingdom is your foundation of your Korean societies. And it's located in South Korea. Then you have your Sui Dynasty. Now your Sui Dynasty is going to rise into power after the Han collapse. The Sui are only around for like 30 years because they're like really hardcore. What I mean by that is they require every single person to do lots and lots and lots of conscripted labor. Who can raise their hand and remind me what conscripted labor is? Oh, God, people. What is it, Ashlyn?
Like you work to pay off your debt.
Yeah, you have to work for the government in order to pay off your taxes. Unlike here in the United States, our government just collects money. Other governments, traditionally, used to have you just do working projects. So, like, the Sui are going to require every single person to do lots and lots of conscripted labor. They are going to do massive, massive infrastructure projects, and their largest one is called the Grand Canal. Now, the Grand Canal, as you see, for me, is just going to be a black line. The Grand Canal is going to be a canal that connects the rivers to increase connection of. That's a terrible explanation of this Grand Canal. The Grand Canal is a system of rivers that go through the northern part of China in order to allow faster trade and negotiations to occur in order to facilitate trade. Have you ever seen a picture of a canal, like a river, that has a really beautiful arching bridge in China? Yeah? That's the Grand Canal. Anytime you see like these boats that are on this like really narrow canal with these really beautiful arching bridges, that's the Grand Canal. It was built by the Sui. The Sui are only in power for like 30 years because they burn everyone out and the people rebel and overthrow because they were just so hardcore. Then you have the Tang Dynasty. Now the Tang Dynasty is going to come in and they are going to be the largest military power China has ever seen. Okay, so they're going to have the largest military conquering than any Chinese dynasty in the history of China, including to today. As you can see, they were pretty successful, correct? So this is the Tang. So the Tang are going to be the cultural heartbeat of China. When the Europeans come in and destroy China for a while, and the Mongols come in and destroy China for a while, everyone is going to reset back to the cultural traditions of the Tang. They are the cultural heartbeat of China. They are considered the peak Chinese dynasty because of how influential they were, how much they invent, how much they control. Now, ladies and gentlemen, as you can see, they expanded very far westward on a very specific path. What did the Tang want to control, ladies and gentlemen? Silk Road, and that's exactly why they conquered this territory, so they could control it much more effectively and make more money off of it, which makes perfect sense. So the Tang are going to conquer this massive territory, so that shows you that they have a very strong military. To maintain it must be that they have a very effective centralized government, right? Because you can't control that large of territory without one. And they do, and they're highly effective. Then you have the Jin Empire, which is going to be like a fluke. It's going to be this pretty color, and it just exists here, and it disappears really quickly. All right, then we have our Southern Song. So the Tang eventually will collapse because it's too big to manage and there's some corruption issues. So, what is going to happen is the Song is going to take over. The Song are going to be major cultural components. They are going to develop things that you think are Chinese. When you think about them, they were created by the Song. Like, they come up with most of your cultural traditions. So, this is the Southern Song. And then the actual Song Dynasty in its entirety is going to be a blue line, a dark blue line, kind of encircling it. And the entire Song Dynasty is this. So the Tang and the Song are the two most influential of Chinese empire, Chinese dynasties. They are the foundation of Chinese culture and government structure. And when the Mongols come in and destroy China after the Song, they are going to reinstate the ideas and beliefs of the Tang and the Song. Pretty cool. All right, that's it. Not a bad map today, right? How much time do I have? So we're going to start some notes after this. Is that okay with you? Oh, okay. That's definitive. That way, if we can get a little bit ahead, we don't have to rush. Because this is a two-chapter week, which means we have a ton of content. Don't forget to color in the rest of China. Japan. Japan. Not China. How is it only Thursday? Ugh. Oh no. You got about one more minute, and then we're gonna move on here, people. All right, if I finish my map, you should have finished yours. Five. Perfect. Four. Three. Is that not the case?
So
why? Some of you are like beautiful colorers, but you're too damn slow. You got 10 seconds, and then we're going to transition to notes. We got things to do. Whew. Five. Four. Three. Two. One. All right, take out your notebook. Let's go. Hopefully you got your maps practically done, yes? Good, because I'd like you to get them done, of course, in class. Some of you did lose silly points on your map this week, which is ridiculous. I know we didn't do it in class last week together, but like, damn, those are easy points. Okay, so on the top of your notebook, of course you're writing week 8, because that's what we do every week. We write whatever week we're in. We are in week 8, and we're going to start with Africa. So, top of your notes, week 8, we're going to start with Africa. All right, here we go. So, now, if you need to write this down, write it down, but we've already talked about it before, but we're just reiterating, because this we haven't talked about Africa in a long time. So, Africa has the Bantu people migrating, and they're the ones spreading language and metallurgy around Africa, correct? Yes, we've remembered this before, okay? So, with that being said, the Bantu are the ones responsible for the spreading of language, metallurgy, and culture. So there's some universal kind of culture at this point. Now, the new crop that's arriving is bananas. This shit is bananas? Bananas. Sorry. Like, you can't help it. So, with the cultivation of bananas, you need to know bananas come from Southeast Asia. Okay? You need to know the bananas originally arrived from Southeast Asia. So, if they arrive in Africa, what is Southeast Asia doing in Africa? Trading. There you go. So, you need to know that Malay sailors are going to bring it to Africa. Now, bananas are the large crop. Everywhere, bananas are going to grow very quickly. You also need to know yams and chickens are coming too. So these new crops and new food source is going to lead to a what? Population increase. So ladies and gentlemen, that's a very big deal. You need to understand that the population of Africa is going to grow very significantly because of bananas, yams, and chickens. You go to Africa today, in every part of Africa, bananas, yams, and chickens are the foundational diets of Africans. Okay? So, population growth is going to boom all over the continent. You need to know that Africa is still a kin-based society. Africa is still a kin-based society at this point. So, that means there are no kingdoms and no centralized governments yet. Okay. Why? Why haven't they had a major centralized government yet? Well, think about it. If one crop can lead to a massive population boom, what don't they have a ton of in Africa? Food. They just don't have a ton of food in Africa. It's actually pretty hard to grow things there. There's not a lot of indigenous crops there that grow well. So if people are struggling for food, do they really have time to make strong centralized governments? No. So that's a huge part of it. You do need to know that the kin-based groups are, of course, ruled by elders. You do need to know that. So, centralized government is out of the question. Now, kinship groups are the traditional ways of Africa, okay? As population grows, It shifts to chiefdoms. You need to understand that it goes from kinship groups to chiefdoms because of a population boom. Because there are more people in Africa, there needs to be more control. With more people come more problems. So it goes from kinship group to a chiefdom. A chiefdom is one person ruling over multiple kin groups. Is this a strong centralized government? No. However, it's stepping in the direction of it. So chiefdoms are like what we had here in the United States with the Native Americans, correct? They had chiefdoms. They had different groups of people who all identified themselves under one ruler. However, did the ruler manage everything or just some things? Some things. That's a chiefdom. Okay? So, once the chiefdoms continue to get bigger and bigger, then it evolves into kingdoms. So it goes kinship groups to chiefdoms to eventually the first kingdom. The first kingdom in Africa is the Kingdom of Congo. You need to know that it's unique because it is the first kingdom in Africa. You need to know that it is a centralized government, the first of its kind in Africa. They use cowrie shells as currency. Does anyone know what a cowrie shell is? You've all worn it. If you've been to, like, the islands in the Caribbean, you've seen it. Cowrie shells. Look like that. And, like, you can wear them in necklaces that you have, like, the rope that goes through them. You know how when you were, like, 12, you were so cool because you went on vacation and you come back? Because they did. Every other civilization. In Latin America, they use cocoa beans. That's currency. Huh? Currency?
Sound like
a shark. You'd want a shark tooth instead? No, thank you. Cowrie shells are what is the currency? You need to know that it is going to exist until the 17th century. So the Kingdom of Congo is going to be a active traders, and they are going to be around until the 17th century. Queen Ndongo is going to be the last one. The Portuguese are going to come in, and this is the first place the Portuguese, the white people, come in and take over. And then they do horrible things to the Kingdom of Congo. Queen Ndongo dresses like a man. She's pretty boss. To try to, like, convince them not to abuse their power in Africa. Doesn't go well, obviously. You don't need to know her yet. She's not around until the 1700s. But her name's Queen Ndongo of the Congo. Alright. So, Kingdom of Congo is going to exist. You need to know it's the first one. You need to know cowrie shells. It's something AP cares about. But that's pretty much it, and it's going to continue to exist. We'll pick them back up when the Portuguese come doing crappy things. Okay. You need to know, I would skip a space and center it, Islam's. I would title it Islam's Effect in Africa. Okay. Islam is going to be carried through Africa via trade routes. What religion is the most popular religion along all trade routes? Islam. The Muslims are the ones controlling all of worldwide trade. The Muslims are the ones who get on their caravans and go to China and purchase the goods, turn around and go back to the Middle East and sell the goods. They are the ones making all of the money. You need to know that Islam is also going to spread through the Trans-Saharan trade route, which you need to know. Trans-Saharan means it crosses the Saharan Desert, so it's a northern route. And you need to know that Islam is going to spread through the Indian Ocean basin trade. So it's coming to Africa two different ways. You need to understand that Islam is going to be the most popular religion in Africa until white people show up in the 1700s and say, convert to Christianity or we kill you. So what do most Africans convert to? Christianity, which is how why most of Africa is Christian today. What?
It's the what basin?
Indian Ocean Basin. So guys, turn around and look at my map in the back. Turn around and look over here. Look at me! Look at me! Look at me! Okay. So, this is the Indian Ocean Basin, because it's called the Indian Ocean. Okay, so we have all these goods in China. We have a ton of goods in India. All of a sudden now, African coast over here is going to start really starting to trade. They are going to sell a lot of pottery. That's the real big African thing, which we're going to get to in more detail. I'm just telling you now. Also, Madagascar is known for its vanilla, not its penguins, by the way. And they are going to be selling this very, very precious root and bean over around the world. So this is going to have a ton of trade. Now, we know this opened during the Gupta because what allows trade to happen? Hello? Monsoon winds. Hello? Do we remember these things? Yes. Monsoon winds are the reason why Africa begins trading. So Indian Ocean Basin is going to start trading with Africa because of the monsoon winds. You also need to know that the trade routes in northern Africa are going to open because we have the invention of camels. Camels are not an invention, but the fact we took them from Saudi Arabia and brought them to Africa makes it an invention. So two major trade routes are happening in Africa. Those two major trade routes are going to bring Islam. Islam will be the most popular religion in Africa. You need to know that camels transform Africa's economy. Camels transform Africa's economy. Beforehand, you couldn't cross it. A horse cannot cross the Saharan Desert. It's too dry for them. The only animal that can do it is a camel. It takes 70 to 90 days to cross the Saharan Desert. A horse will die in about 9 days. Okay, so camels are the only animals that can cross it. Because of this, the Arabs are going to create their own city called Gao. And you need to know that. The Arabs create a city called Gao. It's essentially a rest stop. Because they have so many Muslims going through the Trans-Saharan trade. It's essentially a rest stop. You know, you can get your coffee, get a nice, you know, biscuit. Sit there. All right, that's where we'll end for today. Good. Cool. Isn't it interesting? I don't think you people mean it. What? The train's on hand, right? Please make sure you are putting my crayons back in the box. Please close the box. I didn't think I'd have to tell you this, but like, close the box. Because if you don't close the box, what happens to all the crayons? Yes, look at you people putting it together. So impressive. What up? Yes, my whole day is ruined. I hate it when 16-year-old kids get to do things that have been on my bucket list since I was like 6. It's fine. I'm fine. I hate you so much.
You travel a lot?
No, because I'm poor. Because I chose a terrible career path, okay?
Yeah.
Hashtag regret. Havana, ooh, na-na.
fresh on campus. Fresh out East Carolina, waiting on Mount Bell. Fresh out East Carolina, hop on the pole like a traffic jam. I was quick to pay that girl like Uncle Sam. He go, hey, wait on me. Hey, try to craving on me, get the eating on me. On me. She wait on me, man. Try to caking on me, got the bacon on me. This is history in the making on me. On me. Point blank, close range, that beam. If it goes a million, that's me. I was getting moolah, baby.
Havana, ooh, nah, nah. Half of my heart is in Havana, ooh, nah, nah. He took me back to East Atlanta, nah, nah, nah. Half of my heart is in Havana. My heart is in Havana.
Thank you. got about 30 seconds. Ready? Okay, cool. No one responded. Drain grade!
Oh. All right, here we go. Please.